Thank you very much. First of all, let me take this opportunity to thank my colleague, Professor Govindraju, for having me here this morning. It's somewhat ironic that we are having a drought conference today at a place and in a state and in a region that is having more than its share of water. But then, since I'm coming from Texas, which is so severely drought-stricken, so it is not entirely ironic either. So with that, what really I would like to do here is to kind of give an overview of some of the major drought events that have occurred in the 20th century, in the past century. And when I was asked to give a talk, it's always, when you are given a choice, it's always difficult to come up with a topic that you think will really best fit the overall theme of the conference. So I thought maybe this is something, especially to start the conference, might be a good topic. So really the main question that I had in mind was, what do we learn from what has transpired? That was really the question, and I'm not sure I personally was satisfied with what I came up with, but in any event with that, let's see what do we have. So since drought has severe impacts, and partly we feel the effects of drought because of burgeoning population. So we thought it is a good idea to go back and take a look at the population landscape and also the landscape of water use, because that is where really the drought hits the most. And then of course we will take a look at the droughts that have occurred in the past, and of course now, even though there is some truth to it, but everything is being blamed on climate change and global warming. So maybe it will be a good idea to take a look at if there is a connection between the droughts and climate change. And then of course some few thoughts, conclusion. So let's look at first the global population. And what is interesting here is, now of course as Bruce said, the population is increasing, and it is increasing dramatically. What is interesting is if we look at the beginning of the 20th century, the population was less than 1.5 billion. At the end of the 20th century, the population basically increased more than threefold. It's around somewhere between 6 and 6.5 billion people. Now, of course, the projections are and that by the year 2005, the population will be somewhere between 8 billion and 13 billion. Of course, people feel, or most demographers feel, that the population might be somewhere in the order of about 10 to 11 billion. I personally will tend to be on the higher side, because so far, all the demographic projections have been too conservative. So which means the population is really going to rise on the higher side. What is interesting is that if we look at this population landscape, then we find that the bulk of the population is going to be living in urban areas. And this is even more interesting because this has direct implications, particularly with regard to the effect of drought. Look at it, In 1975, and of course, this blue bars, they basically represent the urban population in developed countries. Now, of course, there they were already urbanized. So really, the increase has been pretty modest. But look at the rural on low and middle income countries. There is a massive migration from rural areas to urban areas. And this is something that we in engineering communities and even in water resources communities, particularly in the research arena, have not really paid as much attention, because this has immediate and direct implications. especially when it comes to droughts and so on. So, you know, there's a massive, look at here in 1975 from here and up to 2010, there is a 3 to 4-fold increase, you know, 3 to 4 times increase in the urban population. And this has enormous implications because this translates immediately into dramatic land use patterns, of course, the local changes in hydrometeorology, and of course, all kinds of other conflicts and so on. So now, if we take even a little closer look at, and much of this is happening in, obviously, understandably, in Asia and in Africa, and especially in Asia, look at in East Asia and South Central Asia, and of course, the South Central Asia, and of course, the Southeastern Asia, which is expected. And that is where really the bulk of human population is also. So, and of course, it is also happening in Africa. Now, of course, so this population rise as I said, has a direct connection with the water use, and of course, the water and the climate and energy, there is a close connection between these two. So, the footprints are in. Obviously, the water is really the very basis for even for energy generation, and of course, the energy then of course the generation has its own implications with regard to the generation of greenhouse gases, and of course that in turn impacts the climate. So it's kind of a cycle. So now let's take a look at the global water use. Of course, all of us know, and even particularly more so, since we are in the heartland of agricultural United States. I mean, Indiana is in the center of, and you see here the much obviously much of the water use. Takes place in the agricultural sector. So, look at here, even in 2000, the water withdrawal as a result of agriculture is nearly 2,500 cubic kilometers. That's enormous water withdrawal. Now, comparatively, on a domestic level, it is not really that bad. It's relatively small. But remember, it is relatively small. But with burgeoning population, it is not going to be relatively small. Partly it is small because of the way people live in Asian countries and African countries. If everybody starts living like the way people live in the United States, we will run out of water pretty quickly. And of course, even in the industrial sector, with respect to agriculture, the water consumption is still quite large. But it is not as large as it is in the agricultural sector. And of course, this also is quite significant. And this is increasing because of very large construction of reservoir activity in mainland China and other countries. So there is a lot of water. Now, what is interesting, I thought, of course, I was not meaning to preach here that all of you should become vegetarian, but I thought it will be interesting to see that, the meaty American diets, European, they cost 5,000 liters of water per day. So basically, even though you are not using it, but because you are eating the type of food you are eating, you are also actually consuming a lot of water. Now, on the other hand, the vegetarian diets, African, they cost only 2,000 liters per. But what is interesting is, look at the case of China. In 1995, the meat consumption on an average, on an annual basis, was only 25 kg. In 2009, it is 50 kg, and it is on the rise. So, and remember, the dietary habits are very difficult to change. You know, once you get used to eating a particular type of food you like to eat. Now, what is even more interesting, and I think this is a news to all of you, because you guys drink a lot of coffee. And of course, being faithful to the profession that I am in, I have stopped drinking. Of course, I never drink tea or coffee. But look at here, 1 kilo of coffee costs 20,000 liters of water. And you know, 1/4 hamburger that most of, especially the young kids, you know, they like to eat this junk food, and you know, it costs 11,000 liters of water. And a cotton t-shirt, you know, 7,000 liters, so 1 kilo of cheese, 5,000. So you keep going, and of course, the wheat and the milk, you know, everything costs a lot of water. Where are we going to get all this water from? And so, now of course, not only food, but look at, you know, look at also the energy generation. But let's first, besides some, you know, the amount of energy that we need, you know, just for bringing the water to the tap, to the tips of your finger, you know, obviously the sources and conveyance, you know, the drinking water treatment, the distribution, bringing to the end use, and finally the wastewater treatment, it all cost a lot of energy. In fact, it cost so much that it is equivalent to nearly 116 billion pounds of carbon dioxide while producing such energy, just for this particular purpose. And this is equal to pollution that is generated by 10 million cars. Enormous amount, something that we don't really think about. But if you look at on average then, the energy production needs about 25 gallons per kilowatt hour. Remember, per kilowatt hour, nearly 39% of freshwater withdrawal in the United States, excluding hydropower, is for operating thermoelectric power plants, an enormous quantity of water that is needed. Now, of course, this is the, you know, energy distribution in the United States, but these are really the freshwater withdrawals. So even though we don't see, because this, you know, this consumption of water does not transpire in front of our eyes, we don't see it, but this is happening. And the type of lifestyle we live in, this is something that we need to think about. What is most important, you know, I would like to, you know, bring this home to you is, if you look at the different sources of energy generation, then we find, then of course, you know, the hydroelectric power is by far, beside the natural gas, is the most efficient way of generating power. This 20 gallons per million BTU. But look at, on the other hand, if you want to generate 1 million BTU using biodiesel, it will be 14,000 to 75,000 gallons. Now, there is a great deal of emphasis these days on being everything green and, you know, producing energy using green. Now, by all means, with all due respect, that is fine. But when it comes to water, that is not the most efficient way of generating energy. In fact, we will, even though you people are rich in water resources, but even here in Iowa, in Indiana, in Illinois, where, which are, you know, which constitute the heart belt of coin production in the United States, you will run out of water. You simply will not have enough water to generate energy if you follow that route. And of course, the nuclear energy, you know, 2,500 to 5,006 gallons of water for generating 1 million BTU. But of course, in this case, you know, there is a lot of water that is basically recycled. And so this figure perhaps is not as accurately reflective of water use. But likewise, all of this, you know, for natural gas and hydroelectric, you leave those two sources of energy generation aside, all others are really highly water consuming sources of energy generation. So where are you going to get all this water from? I think it will be interesting to take a look at the status of fresh water around the globe. Now, according to United Nations, every person needs about 1,700 cubic meters of water to basically to live a normal life. I mean, that is the minimum amount of water on an yearly basis a person needs. If you look at say for example, you know, India and of course you know, the East Africa, even the Southern Africa, they are already in the range where they do not quite satisfy essentially that minimum threshold. But If you look at, obviously, the North Africa, the Northeast Africa, and here in Pakistan, part of Bangladesh, and of course, you look at, part of Europe, there is, the population is already water stress, which is, because the amount of water available on a per capita basis is below 1,000 cubic meters. So, which means that a large portion of the world population is already water stressed, or basically, water deficient. Now, if you look at on a country basis, in Egypt, it has only 26 cubic meters of water on a per capita basis. In United Arab Emirates, it's only 61 cubic meters. Now, of course, there are countries which have abundant water resources, but there are not too many countries. And Iceland, because there are not too many people living over there, and of course, they naturally they have water, but at the same time, they don't have too many people living over there. Now, this slide, essentially, I just wanted to show you that because of the water, and of course, there is a talk these days about water conflicts, and perhaps water it will be the oil of the 21st century, or the gold, or whatever they call, and it might arise to conflict. So basically, this slide shows the potential, highly likely potential. Of course, there are places in Texas where I'm living, and of course in New Mexico, in Arizona, in California, there are places where. There is, to some extent, there is a conflict already. For example, in the Colorado River Basin, there is a conflict between the Colorado River water sharing states. Of course, many of you might know that despite heavy snowfall last year, fortunately in the Colorado Rockies, the lake level in Lake Mead, which perhaps is the largest man-made reservoir in the country, is still about 90 feet below the normal level that it should be. In Lake Powell, which is in Utah, which is a primary source of freshwater supply, the water level is still nearly 40 feet below what it should be. And we don't see any prospects of restoring the water to the normal level. So these conflicts are going to arise. So what are those major droughts? And of course, these are the different types of droughts since, let me rush up before I'm kicked out. Let's first look at there are a couple of articles in Nature in this year. And of course, basically, these articles are saying that the arid regions, many of the arid regions pretty much face quasi-permanent drought conditions. Now, this is something that we often not think about, but this is pretty much true. For example, originally I come from India, and in northern Indian plains, which supposedly are endowed with a lot of water resources, but the fact of the matter is that excepting a very narrow window of time, which we call as monsoon season, throughout the year, the plains suffer from really water deficiency, water condition, because there is no rainfall. So, and this is what is happening even in the southwestern United States, and this is what these articles say: the southwestern climate, in other words, in southwestern United States, may switch to an extended dry mode. Now, the regional drought, then, of course, it has implications, global implications. And for example, last year, there were droughts in Russia and Ukraine that reduced the wheat harvest by nearly 33%. And then, of course, that helped up the wheat prices. Now, of course, on one hand, we were having, as if you recall, in the month of July and August, there were severe droughts and wildfires in Russia as well as in China. On one hand, on the other hand, there was a very massive flooding in Pakistan, which basically flooded nearly 20% of the country. Massive flooding. So we are witnessing these simultaneous occurrences of floods and drought. Now, of course, if you look at the look at some of the major, really major drought events covering about 500,000 square kilometers of area and more that we find in Africa in the 80s, basically all the way from 80 to 86. You know, the droughts was 82, 84, 84, 85, 85, 86. The same thing happened in 90s, 90, 91, 91, 92. In Asia, of course, again in 64 to 1965, 70 to 73, and even in Europe in the 50s, in North America, again in the 50s, then I think all of us, you know, remember, especially in Texas in the 1955, 54, 55, there was a massive, massive drought. I think perhaps the one of the largest, besides the Dust Bowl drought, the largest drought event. And of course, you know, this year, last year, if you look at half the year before that, I think we had a normal year. So we have been gripped with severe droughts for the past nearly 3 years. So these are, these are the major drought events that have occurred all over the world, in Africa, in Asia. But what we find is, what is interesting here is that many of these drought events have occurred in the last half of the 20th century, not in the first half. You know, this is something quite interesting and noticeable, which emerges quite prominently. Of course, if you look at the effects in terms of mortality and in terms of total economic losses, then you find these are the drought mortality risk decibels, that 1% to 4% or 5 to 7% of the population. Look at here, you know, especially in the Asian countries, and then of course in the African countries, and in terms of economic losses, even in the United States, and you know, even in the Midwestern United States, and also along the Pacific Ocean, and then of course in Mexico, and in Brazil, and of course, you know, parts of Argentina, and in Africa. And this is what is happening. In other words, these drought events are impacting almost all of the countries. And if you look at the average population exposed to major droughts, for example, look at the case of China, India, again, Asia, which seems to be partly because of its enormous population, seems to be more highly impacted by these natural disasters. We find, see, look at that, you know, the population, of course, is because the population is very high. So nearly, you know, 50 million people exposed, and these are the number of deaths or the number of people killed as a result of, or who died as a result of drought. And we find that that the population or the number of people being impacted is on the order of millions. And if we look at I think that is also explained if we look at the hydrometeorological factors, for example, in Northern Hemisphere, in Southern Hemisphere, and then on a global basis. But what is interesting is, again, as I said, you look at here in this event, because this is the temperature anomaly in 0 degrees Celsius, and we find in Northern Hemisphere, of course, the temperature was lower. But here, look at here, the temperature is on the rise here, and likewise, this also actually translates into, this is the per degree per 50 years. The temperature actually, this is, I think it should be negative, and this is positive. This is negative, this is positive, and this is the precipitation trend in millimeters per day on a 50-year period basis, and likewise, this is the runoff. Now, in all of this, what we find that there seems to be a direct connection here, and the direct connection is whether we look at on a global basis or in the Southern Hemisphere or in Northern Hemisphere where we are in, we find that there is a significant temperature rise. And this significant temperature rise on an average is translating into a decrease in rainfall for the most part, not everywhere. Obviously, the volume of water has to be conserved in the hydrologic cycle. So it cannot be that way. But in most parts, we are witnessing this phenomenon, that is increase in the temperature and decrease in rainfall. And if we look at, and this is what I was referring to, this is, the Dust Bowl drought event. This is the percent of area that is being impacted. And then, of course, now we are noticing here. So nearly 10% of the total land area in the United States experienced either severe or extreme droughts at any given time. But the total cost is just enormous, $144 billion between 1980 to 2000. And if we look at the flow in the Colorado River, that seems to be on average, obviously there are random fluctuations, but seems to be on the average on the decline. Now, this is something that I wanted to emphasize, that this cost is $144 billion. But do we really have a precise measure for measuring the cost? Because there are all kinds of other costs that we have no way of measuring. There are social costs beside the economic, measuring the economic loss that takes place in the agriculture sector. But there are all kinds of other cost in terms of the loss of ecosystem, the health impacts, the social impacts, and it's very difficult to really put numerical numbers to those costs. If you look at the case of Texas, say for example, look at here. Now, of course, this is the map of Texas, and the severe weather, of course, many of my, in fact, even our own flight was delayed by half an hour, but we were fortunate, but my colleagues, Professor Lavend Kavas and Professor Govind Raju, flights were delayed because of the bad weather. So but leave that aside, in droughts in the western parts of Texas, which pretty much experiences droughts on a semi-perennial basis, look at it, 1995-96, the drought cost $4.8 billion, 2000, again in $2 billion, 2008, 2009, $5 billion. But then the hurricane on the other end, the droughts on the eastern side, there is a massive flooding all along the Gulf of Mexico. And so these natural events are having an enormous impact. But besides the US, if we take a look at our northern neighbor in Canada, again we find the same thing. And what is interesting is that if we look at the period from 1970, 80, it is the drought events are occurring and of course there are periods when really there is no drought, but on average, the frequency of drought seems to have increased during the last 25, 30 years. And if you look at Europe, this shows, for example, if you look at Portugal, Spain and France, these are the impacts of droughts where the effect is in terms of economic losses on the order of billions of dollars. There is enormous damage to the crops, and of course, so this is impacting all over. It doesn't matter which is, of course, in Italy, as you can see here. If you look at Australia, Australia is also having its share. But again, we go back. We keep going that, from 1970 or 1980 onwards, there seems to be this, during this 30-year period, there seems to be an increased frequency of droughts. And of course, this is the, Palmer Drought Severity Index. And this was the major drought, which they call Federation drought, and this is the drought that occurred during World War II. But and these are some of the major drought events from 1895, 2003. But most important is 82, 83, 91, 95. And of course, this is also 1939, 1945. We had the Dust Bowl drought in the United States. So, likewise, in Asia, also on an Asian basis, these are the major drought disaster events. But again, look at here, the severe rise, which is really the, you know, which emerges from 1980 onwards, and it continues to go up. The number of drought events across the whole Asian continent continues to go up. Now, of course, in India, you know, the same thing is happening. In India also, of course, you know, we had now, of, you know, this especially averaged number of rainfall events, drought events, is some does not really quite give you the picture, because there are many places where the droughts are occurring a lot more frequently. On the other hand, there are places where there is a lot of rainfall. So when you do the averaging, it does not quite bring out the seriousness and with which the drought events are occurring. But still, we find even then we find that, look at the period here, from nearly 10-year period where there was a very severe drought, even if we consider the country as a whole. And of course, in Africa, in Sahel, you know, look at it, all the way from 1970, barring maybe a year or two, up to 2010, very severe, serious drought. So the question is there any connection then between the droughts that have occurred all across the globe and, you know, some teleconnections? What do we learn from all these drought events? Now of course, as I said, in Australia, normally it is the Indian Ocean dipole that has a greater connectivity with the occurrences of droughts, whereas in the United States, in Canada, in Mexico, as well as in South American continent, it is the ENSO events where we can find some connections. If we look at, say, for example, and of course in the US, ENSO events normally means El Nino and La Nina. El Nino means essentially it's the warm phase, so enhanced precipitation across the United States. And of course, this year and for the past 2 years, we are having the La Nina phase. But if you look at, you know, just the December, February period, the typical El Nino effects here all across the globe, say for example, in South America, in Brazil, this is, you know, warm phase. Here the conditions will be normally dry. Now in Mexico it will be wet and cool. In the United States, along the Pacific Ocean, it will be warm. Again on the eastern side it will be warm. In Australia, it will be dry, warm conditions. In Africa, especially in the southeastern part of Africa, it will be dry. In the central part, in the eastern Africa, it will be wet. In India, of course, it will be warm. So it all depends really what, you know, where we are. But in the US at least, of course, you are having more than your share of water, and we are having less than our share of water. Because in the La Nina event, La Nina phase, but this is so. And if we juxtapose ENSO events over Texas, over Northwest India, over Southeast Australia, over England, of course we don't observe a one-to-one connection here, but there is a connection here. Say, for example, if you look at La Nina events, say for example, in somewhere in between the middle of 80s, you know, you have La Nina events, and you do find, for example, in England, that there is a drought here, and likewise, especially in, you know, in this period, that you find this period in Texas, of course, there is a severe drought. In Northwest India, you know, there is a drought and there is no drought. So it is hard to say, but in Southeast Australia, again, it is the same thing in England. But if we summarize this, then on average, the recurrence interval of El Nino events is 2 to 7 years, but the Northwest India, it is about 1 to 5 years. So mean is around 1.8 years. In Texas, it is 1 to 5 years. Southeastern Australia, again, 1 to 4 years. The mean is 1.85. In England, it's 1 to 4 years. Again, the mean is 2 years. Now, what is interesting here is, if we look at the recurrence interval of mean annual rainfall, it is around 2.2 years. Now, the recurrence interval here is hovering around 2 years. Now, you know, of course, this is on the opposite side, but maybe there is a connection here. I'm not quite sure. So, let's look at the, you know, look at the climate change and the overall impacts of climate change. All of us know has a direct impact on freshwater availability, on extremes, floods and droughts, on ecosystem and biodiversity, on agriculture, on energy, human health, water supply and sanitation, infrastructure, economy. In other words, really it has a significant impact on the entire social fabric, on our way of life, on us as a society. It has a significant impact. And so, you know, what the IPCC report says is essentially, you know, this is just a brief couple of summary statement that many semi-arid and arid areas are projected to suffer a decrease in water resources. And the proportion of the land surface in extreme drought at any given time is projected to rise. And water supply stored in ice and glaciers is going to decrease. And obviously, then this will affect our agricultural productivity because of the changes in temperature, precipitation, carbon dioxide, fertilization, and everything else. And this change then is going to translate into, you know, human impacts. Now, this is a slide from Diet, from his work in 2010. This is a projection of droughts in the future. Now, of course, really forecasting droughts or forecasting any extreme event is a lot riskier. Forecasting anything is a lot riskier, but certainly extreme events is even more riskier. And this shows, if you look at the look at this scale here, that, you know, the frequency or the occurrences of droughts over large areas is going to be on the rise. And, you know, whether you look at 2009, of course, this has already occurred, so we know it. But in 2030 to 40, 2060 to 69, it's a 10-year period, 90 to 2099. You know, it's really hard, but it does provide some food for thought. It's very difficult to put a whole lot of credence to these projections. But nevertheless, this is something that we cannot ignore entirely either. This is particularly important for water resources planning, even for planning our entire societal operation. And so with that, I think that is, you know, I will simply conclude that droughts adversely affect water resources and, of course, all allied sectors, because after all, water is the basis of our survival. It affects everything that we do, directly or indirectly. And, of course, as I said, as I showed through many slides, that in the 20th century, especially in the later half, the droughts have increased, and not only in terms of frequency and the number, but also in terms of the area coverage they have occurred over. So that has gone up significantly. Now, of course, using, you know, climate models, it seems that there will be a continued drying of many areas, especially the arid areas in Africa, in Asia, even in the United States. And the interarrival time of droughts, it seems, you know, based on very rough calculations, has some connection with these atmospheric phenomena, you know, we call teleconnection. So with that, I think, did I take too much time or? So I think I will end it, but I will be happy to entertain any questions that some of you might have.